on the venture capital industry and entrepreneurial finance. I'm Marion, Frenz. I'm the chair of this 1 hour long session, and I'm one of two deputy directors of the CIMR. Helen is the director, she's also here. Buongiorno, hello Daniele. And today we're excited, we'll be hearing from Dr. Grace Peng, she's from Birkbeck, and from Dr. Yannis, Pierrakis of the UIC Barcelona. So the two presentations are then followed up by reflections from Dr. Muthu de Silva, who's also from Birkbeck. Now both presenters, Grace and Yannis, will highlight the uneven distribution of VC investment. Grace will speak from the lens of the founder and investor characteristics, and in particular the role of gender, and Yannis from an international and regional perspective. So first, a few words about our speakers. Grace is lecturer in management here at Birkbeck, and her research interests include entrepreneurial finance and exit strategy. She's received a PhD from City University, and before joining us here at Birkbeck, Grace worked as a researcher at Warwick Business School. Yannis teaches entrepreneurial finance at UIC Barcelona, and his research interests include venture capital, business angels, startup creation, crowdfunding, and initial coin offerings. But before joining UIC Barcelona, Yannis held positions at Kingston University in London and Cardiff University. He has worked also as an innovation consultant for the World Bank, and was head of investments research at Nesta in London. So following on from the two presentations, Muthu will look at the synergies, the disparities between the two talks, and she provides her own observations. Now Muthu is reader in entrepreneurship and innovation, and she's our assistant dean for research at Birkbeck. Her research, among other things, also focus in particular on knowledge co-creation. The workshop today has come through a really fresh collaboration between CIMR and a research group at UIC Barcelona. So this is our third partnership that CIMR has developed following existing connections with the Kogo School of Business, American University, and Vasa University in Finland. Now, UIC Barcelona and Birkbeck have a long-standing collaboration on teaching and studying. And to this, we have now added another layer, which is research collaboration with the Quality and Innovation for Service Excellence Group at UIC Barcelona, of which Yannis is a member. The group is led by Professor Marta Mas and Professor Frederick Marimon. I think Frederick might be in the audience. And their research is focusing on innovation management, quality management, knowledge creation and transfer, and also entrepreneurial finance, which is the focus for this hour, for the next hour. So we had our first getting to know each other meeting in mid-February of this year. And this seminar today is our first joint UIC and CIMR event. And we hope to have many more of these events in the future. We have a second one planned for the 15th of June, which is focusing on quality standards. Now, I don't want to keep you any longer in suspense. We're now going to the substance of today's talk, and I'll be handing over shortly to Grace. She will be the first speaker. Each of the two speakers will present for around 15 minutes, then move to discussion follows that, and at the end, well, after that, we'll open the floor for all of your thoughts and contributions and discussion points. So there should be plenty of time for that. Without further ado, Grace, please. Thank you.
Okay, sure. On our slides, you can see that, okay?
Yeah.
That's great. It's very nice for me to present this paper, these studies here And also, I'm very happy to join the CIMR debates. Every time is very interesting. And to leave you more time for discussion, my research topic and Yannis' research, I think it's better for me to finish the presentation as soon as possible. Okay. What I want to present today is related with the study with the gender funding gap in the entrepreneur venture capitalist investment. So we know that both in the academic studies or the business reports, they always show that the females have the disadvantaged position in the venture funding. That is to say, usually if a business is funded by a female funder, it's less likely for them to get venture capital investment with the develop, no matter at the different funding stages. So we can see the statistic in this figure to show this disadvantage. And why there is a gender funding gap in the entrepreneur finance? Usually we explain it from different perspective. One, the most important thing is for entrepreneur finance is the uncertainty accounts for a large amount of position, and usually for the venture capitalist, they need to seek some legitimate signal, and gender may perform one important and most visible one. Usually people may think, oh, the male entrepreneur, the male founder are more likely to be a successful entrepreneur. That is what the gender role congruity theory argue. And usually the female is more related with the communal or relational origin attributes, but the successful entrepreneur are more likely to be attributed by his masculine or agentic attributes. This is what usually the male founder show up. So what is the consequence? Usually the female entrepreneur perceived to be less legitimate and competent in gaining the venture capitalist. So what we want to explore the existing funding is that it seems that limited effort has been made to explore the cost significant such kind of discontinuous change in the social environment. For example, the social crisis or economic crisis may create facilitating or constraining these forces on the strength of the perceived general incongruity. That is to say, after each types of crisis, it's possible that the female always have the disadvantage, or it will trigger this disadvantage in gaining the venture capitalist. Or otherwise, after such kind of certain types of crises, the female founder may benefit to attract more venture capitalists. So we think our study is both important in the theory and practice, because the perception on the general incongruity is always socially or culturally constructed. That is how we think that crisis, the social crisis, may have the impact on the institutional environment, may therefore change this perception on the general incongruity. And another thing is the crisis always times of the significant change in such kind of institutional environments. And different types of crises, they may differ in the nature or attribution to in changing the social environment. So that's why we believe the crisis may have play important role in changing the gender role in congruity relationship. And another thing we think the study is important is because the gender gap in the labor market generally, or in entrepreneurship specifically, may receive increasing attention recently. We focus on the female studies more and more, and we want to see whether what may help the female entrepreneurs or the women to gain more powers over the social environment. And sometimes crises may lead to better or worse situation for female. We want to know what type of crisis may lead to the better situation for female, or what type of crisis may lead to worse situation for female, which may need more support from the social environment. So before introduce the main finding of our study, we want to show you what recently there are really more female-funded ventures in comparison with 10 years ago. We can see the percentage of the female-funded venture. In the first figure is the female-funded ventures percentage before or after the COVID-19. And the second one is the percentage of female-funded ventures before after the financial crisis in 2008. So these are the two main crises we select to compare between the female-funded ventures who get the venture capitalist investment. And we can see in the after the 2010, there are more female-funded ventures. The first line is the treatment group, which is more affected by the COVID-19, which set up the business more affected by COVID-19. And the other one, the blue line is a control group who set up the business in the industry less likely to be affected by COVID-19. And we find this is a huge drop after 2019 once the COVID-19 outbreak. So that means no matter we do not think about the entrepreneur finance, only the percentage of the female-funded venture has a significant jump after the COVID-19 outbreak. But it's different, totally different after the great financial crisis. We can find that it's a significant increase in the treatment group after the great financial crisis, that are more female founders set up business in the more affected industries after the great financial crisis. So we see the basic difference between this crisis effect. So our question is trying to further explore how do the crisis may impact the gender gap in the venture funding or financing, or how do different crises may impact the gender gap in the venture financing. So we choose the great financial crisis and COVID-19 because these are true worldwide crises. For the great, and also they are different, totally different in their nature. For the great financial crisis, it may cause the global per capita GDP to drop by 2.9%, and it is led by the low standards in the lending market and abuse of the corporate debt obligations and the risk of the regulation on the financial sector. So this is the cause for the great financial crisis. But for the COVID-19, which is still ongoing, to be honest, this is caused by a pandemic, which is most likely nature-based. And it occurs at a time that the private markets were relatively healthy and the technic development was moving forward before the COVID-19, and also the entrepreneur finance market is relatively healthy. And under this true crisis, we may find the effect of this crisis may have different over the female-funded entrepreneur firm, because a reflection on the dominant masculinity in the finance industry was raised on the media coverage and research in after the great financial crisis. We may find some media mentioned that if the labor brothers become labor sisters, run by the female instead of the male. So maybe would the credit crunch have happened? People challenge it. Maybe if it is led by the females, made by the Lehman sisters, they will be less likely to happen, this great financial crisis. So this challenging norm may change investors' perceptions on the successful entrepreneurial in the future as well. Afterwards, the new venture investors are more likely to invest in the female entrepreneur after the great financial crisis. But it's totally different after the COVID-19. Actually, the overall venture capital industry is rather optimistic towards the future of the invest market compared to the scenario during the great financial crisis. And also, investors are trying to seek more masculine traits to accelerate the business model change under the current situation, especially in the high-tech fields. So under current situation, for many investors, they believe that, the male entrepreneur are more likely to become a successful entrepreneur. Is the male actress fit better with the successful entrepreneur characteristics? So we hypothesize that under this situation, after COVID-19, the new venture investors are less likely to invest in the female entrepreneur. And we also think the investment stages matters because usually at the very beginning, the business angels invest in the setups. They have close relationship with the founder. So this gender signal will not perform that strong effect over the investment decisions. And people may not think that more about think entrepreneur, think male. That's perception. So we think that the impact of the crisis, no matter great financial crisis or COVID-19, on the probability of the investment in the female entrepreneurs will be more pronounced in late stage investments, which perform more by the venture capitalists. So we conduct this study using the primary data source in the Crunchbase, which is a popular popular online database for the venture capitalist industry. And we can find this is the general descriptives for the proportion of female entrepreneurs. This is a good signal that during recent years, there are more female entrepreneurs, especially after the great financial crisis. But we see again, it's a great jump after the COVID-19. And this is the general descriptives we get from the data set. We find that on average, only 9% of entrepreneurs are female, but only 22% of the investors, they may consider to invest in the female setup business. And the average size of the founding team is only 1.8. What we find overall where our statistic analysis is that, which is consistent with our hypothesis that the new venture investors are more likely to invest in the female entrepreneur after the great financial crisis, but they are less likely to invest in the female entrepreneurs after the COVID-19 crisis. And this effect is more significant in the late stage investment. This is consistent with what we proposed. And we also do some additional analysis. Interesting to find that what may affect the female entrepreneur to attract investment during the crisis. We may find if female entrepreneur who graduate from an elite university and who gain a master or above degree are more likely to gain the venture capitalist investment. But if they study in a major like a science, technology, engineering, mathematics, something like that, it's less likely for them to attract the venture capitalist investment. And we want to know why it happened. So we develop an experiment to see what is the mediator between this gender gap and the investment difference. We find that people's investors' perception of the salience of the energetic trees for a successful entrepreneur is the mediator to explain this relationship. More specifically, we developed this such kind of framework to explain this relationship. We find that the crisis, they may change the social environment or social culture to consider what types of people may more likely to become a successful entrepreneur. So for the great financial crisis, people after that, people may think that who are less agentic are more likely to become successful entrepreneur. Then female are believed to be more fit with the successful entrepreneur. Then this perceived fit may lead to the increase in the investment they gained. But the COVID-19 is different. During or after COVID-19, people believe that it's more salient to become more agentic of a successful entrepreneur. That is, female entrepreneurs are less likely to be fit with the successful entrepreneur, which may finally lead them to get less investment from the venture capitalist. So that is our conclusion. To discuss this, so actually we think there is a current discussion of the disproportionate effect of the COVID-19 on the minority groups, not only focus on female, but is not good for all the minority groups in general, and especially in the entrepreneur finance. For example, we saw the headlines in the media such as the business owned by female or minorities have grown, but will COVID-19 undo that? And global VC funding to female founders dropped dramatically this year. So we may find that the situation for female entrepreneurs is really sad at the moment. But what we could do for them? So do you think we think, according to my perspective, I may think that we may try to promote the idea about the females is unfit with a successful entrepreneur, but more likely to introduce some successful female entrepreneur to let the investors or others to think that female could be fit with the successful entrepreneur role as well, no matter under what situation. And also, we need to trigger the females sometimes to present to be more masculine to attract the investors. Or maybe we can try to encourage the investors to study more about the business itself instead of only forecast the signal of this gender. Okay, that's all for my studies. Thanks very much for your listening. And for future studies, as I said, that the COVID-19 is still ongoing. Whether its kind of effect will be long lasting or will be end soon, we don't know it. Maybe in the future study, we can further discuss it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Frenz. That's excellent. We go straight to Yannis. Grace, maybe you need to stop sharing your slide. That's. And then Yannis can share his slides. Excellent. Maybe you need to go into presenter view. I think we've got the PowerPoint frame.
Oh, I think I did. Can you see me? Can you see it well or not? No?
Yeah, you can see the slides.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. So, thank you very much for coming for this short workshop. And I just want to build on what Grace already mentioned. We also see the gender gap issue in terms of investors as well. So not only, you know, when startups try to raise money, but also when the venture capitalists, you know, make the investments, when we look at who are these people that make the investments, 83-85% are obviously male. So the gender gap is also at the supply, not only at the demand side of the VC industry. Anyway, so I'm going to talk about something slightly different. I'm going to talk about the foreign venture capital investments. We use the UK as an example, but I think the findings and perhaps the challenges we have identified apply to other countries. For example, now we are based in Spain, and I see there are some Spanish people attending this workshop. And also we see this geographical heterogeneity in both countries. So most of the investments in the United Kingdom are in London, Southeast, etc. And in Spain, most of the investments are in Barcelona and Madrid. And we'll see the same happening in terms of foreign venture capital investments. So this is a follow-up work. Originally, we started a few years ago with Colin Mason, and we looked at the publicly backed investments, right? So not foreign venture capital investments, but investments that came from basically funds that received public support. And this is basically a follow-up. The purpose of this work is to identify a phenomenon, to describe a phenomenon. Well, basically, you will see from the data analysis that foreign venture capital investment are becoming more and more prominent. And the purpose of this work is just to make you aware of this phenomenon, to discuss whether we need to respond to this phenomenon, and what the implications to the regional development of venture capital industry this may have, and of course to get some inspiration for future research questions. Okay, so this work has been done together with my colleagues from Kingston University, Johanna Babangida, and Professor Richard Harrison from University of Edinburgh. So this is a snapshot of what is happening in terms of the domestic funds. So these are, let's look at the UK, for example, just to... Sorry, I can hear somebody... Can you please mute yourself, because I can hear somebody is changing the page or something. Thank you. Okay, so let's look at the United Kingdom, and what you see here is how the local venture capital funds invest, the British. So the rest of the country is the blue collar, and London is the orange. So you see only around 50% of the money are invested in the UK, and the remaining, let's say 50%, is invested outside the United Kingdom. Okay, so we see in the United Kingdom we have the British fund, half of the money is invested outside Britain. We don't see the same in France. You see in France, the majority stay in France. And in Germany, yes, we see that there is also a huge internationalization of the venture capital industry. Now, what do we mean? We want to focus now on the money coming in to the country, okay? Not the money coming out. So we look at foreign venture capital investments. And we refer to foreign venture capital investments as when the investment is made to a company outside the domicile home country of the investor. So is this a good thing? Is it a good thing for a company to receive such an investment? So the literature shows that yes, for the company performance, it's a very good thing, because it accelerates sales growth. It helps the company to achieve an IPO quicker and get high proceeds than companies that did not receive venture capital investment. But a question is different. A question is whether it's a good thing for regional development, not for company growth. Okay, so this is the debate we're having here. So let's look at what's happening in terms of our research objectives. We want to investigate what's happening in the UK in terms of geography of this foreign venture capital investment. And we want to identify whether there is a pattern, how these foreign guys invest. Do they invest alone? Do they invest with the local fund? Do they invest with the London fund etc., etc. Do all regions benefit from this phenomenon? And if not, what are the implications for policymakers? So our sample contains over 12,000 transactions. That means individual transactions, or around 6,000 unique investments to over 3,000 companies in 18 different countries in a period of 14, 15 years. And we use Thomson Reuters for this data. Although I agree with Grace, Crunchbase is also good. Now, what's happening, the overall picture in the United Kingdom? So you see from 2002 to 2017, this is the last year we have data for. The dark blue or the blue color indicates foreign investments that have made to British companies only by foreign investors. So there is no British investor involved in this, in the blue color. The orange color indicates when an investment is made by a foreign investor and a British investor together. So when they invest together in, obviously, in British companies. And the gray color indicates the proportion of investments that are made without any involvement of a foreign investor. So I'll just focus on 2017, and you will see the majority of venture capital investments in the United Kingdom had one or more foreign venture capital investors. That's what this graph means. The second finding, or the second key message of this graph, is you can see the trend. Okay, the orange color is becoming bigger and bigger at the expense of the gray color, not the standalone, which is the blue investments. So we see that the standalone foreign venture capital investments. Wow. So for example, when an American fund invests on its own in a Bristol company, that is blue. When an American fund invests together with a London fund in a British company in Bristol, let's say, that is orange. And gray, it's only the local deals, a London fund invest in Bristol or in London. Okay, so we clearly see the trend, more and more foreign venture capital investments. And this is happening everywhere, not just in the UK. Okay, we wanted to see where exactly this is happening. So we looked at the individual round. So round one, first time they receive investment, round two, et cetera, et cetera. So as you see, round four, 50% of the deals involve a foreign investor, okay? Either they invested on their own or with somebody else. And then it's becoming more and more prominent. So when the company is less riskier, because I received many rounds, when it's more successful and older, then attracts more investors, okay? Or the foreign guys are more attracted to this kind of deals. We also see the same trend only when we look at the first round, the very first time they raised money. So there again, we see a huge growth in foreign investments. And let's look now at the regional level, because that's also interesting. What do we see here? Really, the regions that they have very high proportion of foreign venture capital investment is, as you expect, London, East of England, and South East England, and Southwest England, the usual suspects, okay? And we see all other regions, with the exception of Northern Ireland, but this is skewed because of the Irish Republic investment, yeah? All the other regions, nothing is happening, or not much is happening. Yeah, they receive a very small proportion of foreign investors. So all this foreign investment, the majority of this foreign venture capital fund, comes to companies that are based in the usual, in the suspects, London and Southeast. What we also find very interesting is the London effect. So even if when foreign investors want to invest, let's say, let's pick the East of England or Southwest England, they prefer to co-invest with a London-based fund, not with a local-based fund. Okay, so the London guys are really very active all over the country, not just in London. So they co-invest with the foreign investors in other parts of the country. proportion of foreign venture capital investments by region. This is the first, on the first column, and you will see there is a steady increase in terms of proportion. 65% in London, 68% in the east of England, etc., etc. But when you look at the proportion of each country, if the UK equals 100, you see only the UK is going up. The other regions are going down, so they are losing proportion compared to London. And also we looked what countries really are the most active, and you see clearly the United States. Okay, the United States is the main investor in the United Kingdom, as expected. Okay, key findings. As I discussed, venture capital investments have become a significant and in later rounds a dominant supplier of VC finance in the UK. And there is a regional heterogeneity, not only in local investments, where we knew already, but also in foreign investment. So it's a mirrors the image. In northern regions and the Midlands regions with extensive public support, the VC activity is significantly limited. They don't invest in these regions. Also, we see that stand-alone investments are still very prominent. But we were wondering why VC foreign venture capital funds prefer to invest in London. And what are the implications of these preferences? So we know from the literature, they are attracted to London-based companies, or let's say Southeast, because of the quality of stock. Okay. Also because of the ties between foreign venture capital funds and London venture capital funds. Remember, the London venture capital funds are very global. They have a global view. They have branches in other parts of the world. Local funds in northern regions and Midlands may have limited ability to establish strong social ties with foreign funds. And this has direct implications to their ability to attract this kind of investments. These regions are mainly dependent on publicly backed venture capital funds, like Wales, for example, may not be as smart as the private sector. And therefore, there is a huge literature on this, okay? And therefore, the foreign venture capital funds may not prefer these GPs as their partners. They prefer private funds. What we know for sure, we know is that foreign investors, because they come from the United States, are much larger. They invest larger amounts. They're able to follow up their investment much than the local ones, much more, which is a good thing because they improve the employment in the particular region, innovation, productivity. We know all this from the literature. However, what we just found out, this is unpublished work, the foreign investors take a larger proportion of the company. So when they invest together with local ones. So this, we need to think about the implications of this thing. A foreign investor lacks proximity with its portfolio companies, and this has implication on what kind of support they really can provide to their portfolio. Foreign funds lack the local knowledge, the connections, and the contribution to the local ecosystem that we want to build in each region, the regional innovation ecosystem, could therefore be questionable. There is also some discussion whether foreign investors may crowd out local investor at the expense of the local investor. And this could slow the growth of local VC markets, which we really need. This is what we want. Local GPs, local venture capital funds, may be considered second best by these few star entrepreneurs that exist in, let's say, in other regions outside London. And they may lose out to the foreign investors because obviously these star companies will prefer a fund that is based in Silicon Valley. The problem here that we see is that quite often foreign investors, because particularly they have a large chunk of the company, they require that these companies relocate to the fund's country of origin, mainly the United States. So what are the implications of this relocation? So these companies move together with their staff, together with everything else that they have. This has significantly a negative implication to the host region, as it results in brain drain, loss of employment, etc., etc. However, you cannot really stop this happening. So how much relocation of these portfolio companies will happen is largely a function of how strong the domestic ecosystem is. So if a company sees a real reason to stay in a particular region, it will stay if this, they see a value, if the ecosystem is strong. So perhaps this is where should be a focus, how we can make this ecosystem stronger to be attractive to this company, so they will not be forced to relocate to the United States. So the role of public makers is vital in ensuring access to international venture capital markets through increased volumes of networking, etc., etc. But bear in mind that regions with less vibrant ecosystems like East Midlands, Wales and Yorkshire are more vulnerable to this risk associated with the foreign venture capital investments. And the above concerns calls for a balanced approach when policymakers at the national or regional level explore ways of encouraging foreign venture capital investments. So what kind of foreign venture capital investments we want? Perhaps those ones that they seek to strengthen the domestic ecosystem, not all type of investments, okay? So there is a huge debate of smart specialization and all that. So this debate is very much linked to this debate. So the effort of the regional authorities should focus on attracting foreign venture capital investments that are closely linked with the regional industrial strengths. I'm thinking about the northern England, et cetera, et cetera. And encourage them to co-invest with local funds. And I know I'm running out of time. So what the government can do? For example, at the national level, the British Bank could encourage industry-targeted foreign venture capital investment with local funds that are based in regions in the north, let's say. This can be done either at the fundraising level, so when the fundraise and the government behaves as an LP, they can give incentives to a foreign GP to raise funds together with a local VC. Okay, there's many tricks that the British have been doing these kind of funds. They know really well how to attract private money now into the industry. Or the deal level, you know, investors can receive incentives when they invest together with local funds at the deal level rather than the fundraising level. Another good idea will be to help the local GPs to improve the quality, to improve the ability to network with foreign funds and also London funds that are very well connected. So the local governments, local authorities can organize networking opportunities to help these local GPs. And this is my conclusion. We argue that policymakers should take a closer look in this fast-changing industry that is becoming rapidly globalized, not only in the UK, okay? As I told you, also the UK funds invest a lot outside, but the UK companies receive a lot of money from abroad. And we see this happening in the whole Western part of the world. But what's happening, what is the implication of this phenomenon to the other parts of Britain outside London? This is, I think, where we need to pay some attention, especially in the light of Brexit. And that's it. I'll finish, Marion, with that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yannis, and thank you, Grace, for the very thought-provoking talks here. Without further ado, Muthu, I'll invite you to give your reflections, please.
Thank you very much, Marion, and hello, everyone. So very nice to see you, and I can see many familiar names in the list. So again, thank you very much for joining us today. So I hope that where you are is also as nice as London. It's very sunny and bright, 22 Celsius degrees. So, right. So let me take this opportunity to thank Yannis and Grace for your excellent presentations, really interesting insights. So as a discussant, I thought of briefly discussing three key elements. First, to remind us the focus of the two papers, and second, to highlight inequalities or the heterogeneity highlighted by these two papers. And third, to offer some reflections of the key findings. So if I move to the first point, So it's really great that Yannis focused on the macro perspective, whereas Grace focused on the micro perspective. So in relation to the macro perspective, Yannis discussed the status of foreign venture capital investment in the UK and its regional differences. In relation to the micro perspective, Grace discussed the female entrepreneurs' ability to secure venture financing during two different types of crisis environment. And then if I move into the second point where they have discussed inequality or the heterogeneity, Yannis highlighted at least two forms of heterogeneity. One, the different forms of investment, and the other, the regional disparity, of course, among other disparities that you have discussed. So in relation to the different forms of investment, Yannis demonstrated that while the deals without foreign venture capitalists are decreasing, foreign venture capitalists with co-investment of local venture capitalists is increasing, and standalone foreign venture capital market is a bit stable. So, and among many regional disparities outlined by Yannis, I found that the one on co-investment is quite interesting, because co-investment is the highest in London and East, Southwest and Southeast of London. On the other hand, co-investment is the lowest in Northwest and Northeast of London, England, Yorkshire and West Midlands. So the Grace highlighted the heterogeneity in relation to gender and the nature of the crisis. So her findings suggested that the new venture investors are more likely to invest in female entrepreneurs after the great financial crisis, perhaps due to risk-averse behavior of females, which investors may have found very attractive at that point in that crisis. But on the other hand, new venture investors are less likely to invest in female entrepreneurs after the COVID-19 crisis, perhaps because investors were seeking more masculine traits to accelerate the business model change in the high-tech fields, and also to better prepare for the future once the pandemic is over. So these traits, such as masculine traits, were quite often believed to be possessed by males than females. So by looking at these key findings, finally, I would like to highlight three interesting trends and reflections I thought quite important, and also these are emerging from these two presentations. First, I think there is a very strong rationale for co-investment by foreign venture capitalists and local venture capitalists. I think, as also Yannis highlighted, such co-investment could overcome some of the challenges, such as foreign investor lacking local knowledge, connections, and proximity. This would also avoid foreign investors overcrowding our local investors. So I think the question that I would like to leave with the audience is, how can we incentivize more co-investment by foreign and local venture capitalists? So I think this is a crucial area the policymakers as well as practitioners should look into. And second, there is a strong rationale for strengthening local ecosystem. So the first, this would avoid foreign investor-backed companies moving out of local ecosystem. And second, it would attract more foreign co-investments. So the question that we should be asking is, how can we improve ecosystems by building on their unique strengths? And also, would the leveling up agenda the UK government has recently introduced make a difference in this regard. And third, based on the great findings came from Grace, I was just thinking, can both males and females develop the traits desirable for a specific crisis environment in order to avoid the gender gap? So my question here is like, is a trait gender specific? Can't the demonstration of such traits be determined by other factors such as experience, age, knowledge and network, and also the learning of those traits? I know that the traits seem to be a little bit, you are born with the trait, but can't you learn the trait and demonstrate in order to achieve your objectives? So for instance, once we learn these findings from Grace's excellent presentation, let's say in a great financial crisis, can't males also demonstrate risk-averse traits? And is having masculine and agenting traits gender constrained? Can't some females also have, or can't they develop masculine or agenting traits so that they could secure investment during a crisis like COVID-19? Okay, so by leaving those reflections with you, I would like to conclude my discussion. Again, I would like to congratulate both the presenters for your excellent presentations. And now I would like to hand over to Marion. Again, Marion, thank you very much for organizing this as well as inviting us. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Muthu. That's wonderful and very thought-provoking. Three questions that might help prompt more discussions. But now the floor is open to everybody if you want to raise a point, an observation, either in response to the three questions raised by Muthu or anything that you saw that captured your eye or your imagination during the two talks by Grace and by Yannis. Then please, yeah, we've got Henry who's got his hand raised. Would you like to unmute? Are you still on mute?
How about now?
Perfect, yes, can you?
Okay, well, good to join you virtually from Sand Hill Road, actually. So my observation is this. It seems that the Northeast is where it always is, behind. And so I say that from my time in Newcastle, 05 to 09, that it seems that not much has changed. The great hopes for Science City in that era, still not yet realized. So what can be done? What comes to my mind is the Swedish experience with the Almi Fund, that is government-funded regional-based venture capital entities. That is one model that does not seem yet to have been taken on board. At least I didn't hear that there was yet a Northeast Fund. Now, I know that back in the day, the Northeast rejected having a separate entity with its own parliament, etc., for various reasons. But nevertheless, it seems that a higher level of regional status is still indicated. I always thought that perhaps the answer could be found by the Northeast joining Scotland, and that could solve the problem. When I was in Newcastle, there were always delegations from Edinburgh coming down, wanting to collaborate, always wanting, but not much local take up. So that's one possible solution. The other is the Israeli Yasma model, which has probably been tried in the UK by now, I would guess, of joint public-private with the public incentivizing the private to join. But nevertheless, it does not yet seem to have been applied regionally, even with the so-called leveling up bump, shall we say. Finally, I would note that 10 years ago, when I would interview, they would still be told that the rule of thumb for Silicon Valley Sand Hill Road Venture Capital Investment that you had to be within 1.5 hours drive time of Sand Hill Road. However, sometimes when the interview was coming to a close, the respondent would say, oh, excuse me, I have to catch my flight to Shanghai. So that was an indication that something was changing. There was normative change underway, and the investments were internationalizing. However, I doubt that it has gone so far that Silicon Valley has reached Newcastle. So you guys will have to take that on board and still solve that regional problem locally, especially since you've gone the Brexit way. Because what was happening in the Northeast was that funds were coming in from Europe, but no one would admit it. You could find a plaque on the wall of a biotech research center, but it was off in a corner, and it was not admitted. You could see the same in Manchester. By that time of the Manchester Triple Helix meeting, the UK had insisted that notices be put up as to where the money was coming from. So I leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you. Yannis, I can see you smiling and nodding. Would you like to respond? Or?
To respond, no. First of all, nice to finally meet you, Henry. I know we had some issues with the special issue, so we couldn't meet. So it's nice to meet you now. Yes, no, I totally agree. The Yozma model has been the most successful in Israel. And I think, yeah, you're right. It hasn't been applied at the regional level. So that could be exactly just copy and paste because it worked well with the connections to the US funds. They did, as far as I'm aware, they did have the regional venture capital funds in the UK a few years back, but they had many constraints. And I think that was one reason that they didn't work quite well. And also, perhaps they were not well equipped. So they did try with some regional funds as well. But as I said, many, many restrictions, et cetera, et cetera. But yeah, thank you very much for sharing your views, Henry.
We have time for more reflections, maybe one, two more from the audiences, if there are. You can also use the chat if you don't want to unmute, and I'm very happy to read out any questions that you might have. So I just see hands going down, I think, maybe. If there's no, I don't want to jump in and somebody is at the minute just thinking about a question. I can see Henry's hand going up and down. Somebody else who'd like to make another interjection? Henry, is this a legacy hand or you'd like to make one more point?
Oh, well, I hadn't intended to, but I do have one. I was just trying to lower my hand. That's why you saw it going up and down. I was unsuccessfully trying to lower. But I would just add one more point, which is the experience in Brazil of importing the Yasma model, which occurred as a sideline to the 2000 Triple Helix Conference in Brazil, where the Brazilian Development Agency hosted a delegation from Israel in order to import the model. What they found was you could not just bring it in whole cloth. You had to make local adjustments. So, for example, they had to teach the local entrepreneurs how to pitch for investments. So the Brazilian agency established a venture capital university in which they would send out teams around the country to educate, to give training, and how to do pitching. Now, of course, by now, that's well distributed through entrepreneurial education programs everywhere in Brazil. So that wouldn't be the point right now. And it's probably also not the point for the UK, since that's also been likely distributed through the widespread expansion of entrepreneurial education. When I was at Newcastle, it wasn't yet kosher to say the term. My chair was called Chair of Innovation, Creativity, and Enterprise. But that, as we know, has long changed. So anyway, the point is to carefully analyze the local situation, the SWOT analysis, to make sure when you import a model that you adapt it to local circumstances, as well as invent something that will work in the situation. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, Henry. I see we've just a couple of minutes over time. Maybe if there's nobody raising their hand or speaking in the chat, just wanted to maybe leave one comment with the speakers. I want to thank you for your time, and I think they were both really insightful talks. We've looked at the uneven distribution of venture capital investments in terms of the region, international, regional, in terms of the characteristics of the founder. And what we haven't looked at, I think, much, but which could maybe in both of your papers play a role, is the industry, the sector, the type of business that you're looking at, and that could make differences to the extent to which there are disparities or differences in funding. I just wondered if that is something that you had done that or be looking at. But you don't need to respond. That was, if not, I would like to thank both of you and Muthu as well for your thoughts, for your presentations, for making this a successful event, for joining me and my colleagues at CIMR today. Of course, Grace and Muthu are also members of CIMR. For Yannis and all colleagues from UIC Barcelona, a shout out in particular. I hope we'll have many more joint events here. So I can see Nicoletta. Has her camera on, and many of our colleagues here. So I'll formally close the session now, and I thank you all for your time, for coming and for joining us from wherever you are. These online meetings are great, to come together across boundaries, across different regions.
Thank you very much, Marion. Thank you all.
Thank you so much.